Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. So machine can generate a tremendous amount of log data, and this presentation is about reducing the complexity of log files to narrow down the interesting bits. If you take a picture of this slide, you can use the QR code to download the slides with the speaker notes. So we are OpenStack engineer. Dirk works for SUSE, and he's troubleshooting OpenStack since Folsom. And he spends too much time looking at log files.
Thanks, Tristan. So Tristan is working for Red Hat and is member of the vulnerability management team for over 3 years now. And part of his work is focused on CI/CD solutions. So to give you a reason why we're here, we love OpenStack Health. OpenStack Health is a front end for the OpenStack CI system. It's a huge CI system. It's supporting the OpenStack software development. And it produces daily a tremendous amount of log files, results of tests, and so on, over a large variety of different jobs. And the OpenStack Health website gives you a good way to introspect the testing results. So in this graph, you can see that fairly regularly, one particular job that I just picked out of random is being run in the infrastructure over a couple of days. And occasionally, there are jobs that are not always passing. This is sort of normal. But it's really important to get to the root causes of those frequent or infrequent failures. In order to have a stable and more predictable result when you're changing the software. So whenever jobs fail unexpectedly, people, engineers that work on OpenStack have to look at the log files and figure out if there's a certain pattern in this failure that needs to be solved in the software or in the CI environment. So usually, OpenStack Health gives you this kind of overview, but then after some time, you actually click on some link and you end up on something that looks roughly like this. Please raise your hand if you have had this experience of like lots of text, gray on white, no idea what's going on. So I give you a hint. There's actually an error here. Who can see the error? Raise your hand. So I made it easy because I only extracted 2% of the total log file. So the error is actually when you know Ansible, you can sort of see the structure of like tasks getting executed, and you can see a failure report at the lower end of the slide, and you can guess, okay, there has to be an error somewhere near that line. Okay, so who found it? Okay. There are a couple of people that are greater or braver than I am, pretty good. So to cap this up, a lot of the analysis of test results is a manual process that takes a lot of time. So you're looking at the job results, you get a whole bunch of log files. Usually you have to start with the top level log file, which you open in a separate browser window, then you scroll. You find a failed task somewhere, and that failed task is associated with a timestamp, and then using that timestamp, you can look up the similar timestamp in the service log files that are siblings of that particular log file. So usually, the failed task is not enough to figure out the root cause, but you instead need to look at what the services were thinking about the state of the overall system at that particular point in time. So you open more browser tabs and you introspect the individual service logs. Also have to do a lot of scrolling and matching in order to figure out how things are led to that failure. And this is usually quite tedious and time consuming. And not always the actual root cause of the failure is labeled with a string called error or failure that you can easily grep for in your browser. Sometimes the failure is just a combination of things that haven't been already tagged as an error in the code before. So our vision that we want to present here is that you can go directly from the job results to finding a root cause without like a lot of manual tasks in between. And we believe that actually most of the tasks that I presented before, you can automate, or you, tooling can automate it, this for you. And even in non-obvious cases, like for example race conditions or feature flags being turned on and off depending on particular corner cases, an automatic process can help you isolate that better. And to give you a small sneak preview of the tool that we're going to introduce is, so this is the same, very same log file that I showed you before. And the difference here is pretty obvious. So you see a red line, which is a line of a log entry that is animal or considered animal by the log analysis tool. And this actually gives you already a good starting point for further root cause analysis.
So thank you. Thank you for this presentation, Dirk. Today's plan is in three parts. First, we'll do a short introduction to machine learning. Then we'll look at the log classifier implementation. And we'll do a CI integration demo. But first, a bit of taxonomy. So AI, or artificial intelligence, is a growing branch of computer science with a very broad scope. Machine learning is a field of artificial intelligence that uses statistical techniques. And nearest neighbor is one of the simplest of all machine learning algorithms that we will explore today. In this presentation, Build defined a generic process that generates logs, such as a CI jobs, a deployment script, or a service operation. The baseline define a nominal build, and target will be the build that we want to analyze. In this first section, I'll introduce the base principle along with two objects that can be used for logs processing. It's namely the hashing vectorizer and the nearest neighbor model. Note that other models may easily be used while keeping the same workflow. So let's look at a generic training workflow. This diagram shows how baselines are processed to train a model. And the raw text lines need to be converted before being used by a machine learning model. Then we can repeat the same process to test the target. And after the model has been trained with nominal data, it can eventually detect the noise from the target data and report what went wrong. Next, we will see how to implement such model. We already know what is not relevant for log analysis. Random words such as a date or IP address can be replaced by a known token. And we'll see that doing generic tokenization greatly reduces the complexity of this problem. After tokenization, log line needs to be transformed into something more convenient for machines. And the hashing vectorizer converts each word into a numeric hash value using a hashing trick. Then it encodes the token occurrence information into a sparse matrix array of all the possible hashes. So each vector is very sparse as it only contains the line tokens. And the vectorizer is used on each log lines, whatever its source or structure. As an example, this is the job output of a DevStack jobs. On the y-axis, there is the log line. So in this example, it's 34,000 vectors that are represented horizontally. And on the x-axis, it's the token occurrence position. So the green dots show baseline vectors, and the red dots show target vectors. And this representation shows all the vectors in order. So what we want to do is look for the distance of each target vector to all the baseline, whatever the order. So next, we will see how to interpret those vectors. And we'll use the nearest neighbor model, which is a model that learns from baseline vectors, our training data. And it enables efficient regression analysis to quickly compute the distance of target vectors to the baseline. And we do that by using the k-neighbors query. So this example illustrates a search from the previous DevStack example. So the raw logline is converted to a vector of tokens, and the k-neighbors function returns the distance of that vector from the closest baseline, and it's a value between 0 and 1. So in this case, the line contains unknown tokens, showed in red, and that increases the distance a lot. This is a preliminary work based on the hashing vectorizer, and it works very well for a large majority of log files, but it has limitations. The current nearest neighbor implementation actually uses a brute force search algorithm, which means that the search complexity grows linearly with sample size. It's also kind of an unsupervised learning model. Thus, short failure message may be indifferent from noise. And finally, a nearest neighbor doesn't work well if the log file contains too many sparse features. So for example, the Mistral service log may contain the full request body, and that generates very long log lines, which makes the vector very different, and computing the distance does not result in relevant information. However, most log files have a limited amount of possible variation. So this graph shows the number of unique vectors found in jobs. On the y-axis, you have the number of vectors. And on the x-axis, the number of jobs used to collect those vectors. And this second graph shows a search time growing linearly with sample size. So on the y-axis, you have the search time of 512 vectors in seconds. And on the x-axis is the number of samples being used by the model. So according to those measurements, sample size or model being trained with more than a million vectors aren't very practical because it will take 40 milliseconds to compute one distance, which is too long for processing all the output of a single job. And even 500,000 vectors is like a kind of a limit for this implementation. The next section introduces an easy-to-use implementation of this technique.
Thank you, Tristan. And thanks a lot for allowing me to introduce the tool that actually he originally wrote. So hopefully I'm not going to butcher it too much. So what is log classify? Log classify is a Python tool based on scikit-learn, which is a machine learning framework. The machine learning framework scikit-learn provides a set of algorithms for efficient data analysis like big data and also machine learning techniques. It has some support for text-based learning, so it provides various standard models like the bag of words approach or the hashing vectorizer that Tristan was explaining earlier. And in our experience, the hashing vectorizer is actually most efficient when you let it run on machine-generated, so actually log files that are generated by automated jobs, rather than like other text classification tools that are more trained or more were created originally for analyzing human-written, like literature or similar text input. And the only assumption really that it assumes is that it expects that you pass in a text-based input. It should be line formatted, so it's not handling anything else. In order to install it, it's actually fairly easy, so you can use pip to install it. You can also install it with your distribution provided packages if you want to. And when you invoke it, it gives you a help screen. And then go over that fairly quickly. So the main modes of usage are listed here. So the first one is diff, which allows you to give you two parameters, like two files, and it will try to reduce the diff between those two files and give you a reduced output. You can also give it a set of files in from a directory, which is the dir command, which is used for. And in order to tweak that more, you can separate the training and the actual run step in two different passes. And there are more advanced use cases, like, for example, the SUL integration, so that you can directly connect it to a SUL instance, and it will download and integrate the log files that are being locked or stored there. So the assumptions of log classify is that you feed it build logs. And if the build result was successful, then you add that particular log file to your baseline. So the baseline is a collection. It's a model of known good inputs that you want to be subtracted, basically, from the log that you're actually looking for. So the nearest neighbor algorithm that Tristan was explaining earlier is a variation of a non-generalized training. So the model is not actually trying to build a representation of the data, it's merely storing the data. So it's the baseline, or the model is a store of all the data that you have fed into it. And you build it basically from the successful runs, and then you run it as a target against the failed run. So to give you this in a graphical, simple overview, so I took a picture of a pile of leaves, and on the right side, there are a couple of differences. Can you see more than one? Can you see one? Yes, yeah. Okay, most people see one difference. Can you see more than one difference? Yes, there's someone saying two differences. And this is a problem actually humans are really bad at, because you just can't see it. So this is the binary diff of the two pictures, and you can see there are actually a couple of changes. And it's fairly easy to spot the most obvious one, but it's really hard to spot all the others. And sometimes when looking at log files, actually the non-obvious thing is leading you more directly to the root cause than the obvious thing, not always. So to make it as simple as possible, we are running it against the dev stack drop. So I'm calling, so I already prepared a log file, so I have a known good log file, and I have a known bad log file that failed somewhere. And I'm just calling log reduce diff on it. And as you can see, it processes it within a few seconds, and it reduces the output from the bad log file to what it considers anormal or not part of the good log file. And you can see in this example, where it created a model on the fly in the background and didn't store it actually on disk, that it already provides a reduction from like the original 35,000 lines to 700 lines. So 700 lines is still a lot, but it's a lot less than the 35,000 lines before. And in this particular case, one of the highest hits is actually the one that is actually the main error that you can find in this log file. And to visualize that a bit more, you can actually store that model and like try to make a graphical representation of it. So in this example, I used the standard algorithm. It's called truncated singular value decomposition. It's part of the scikit-learn framework, so I didn't have to implement anything myself. I just had to use the framework. And what it's actually doing is it reduces the model, which has like a million rows or as dimensions, because each word is being encoded as either a one or a zero in a row, to a 2D graphics. So the 2D graphics actually doesn't tell you that much about the structure of the data, but it like tries to flatten it and tries to sparse it out so that you can see some kind of relationship. So in this graph, you can see the gray dots. The gray dots is the actual rendering of the raw input log file. And the red logs, or the orange colored dots in the picture, is the reduced log file that we actually train the model against. So log classify has, in addition to the vectorizing step, a feature extraction step where we are like ignoring tokens that we consider completely random, like for example date strings or IP addresses or any other unique IDs. And this reduction is is unsafe because we are ignoring a lot of input. But on the other side, that increases the efficiency, so you don't have to train on a large collection of sample log files in order to get a good result. So I already introduced that you can run it against a single file as a baseline, but you can improve the accuracy of the output by training a model on multiple sample inputs. So the normal use case is that you do a two-phased approach. You first train on a collection of log files that you consider good or part of your baseline, and then you run it against the log file that you're actually looking for. So in this case, I was running it against 8 log files. And one question that you could have in mind is, why did I pick 8? So I did actually a small test for DevStack log files. And you can see here that in my particular example that I randomly picked, even training against one sample already gives you a large deduction of the total output. But training against more samples gives you a much better result. And you can see actually it's plateauing. So in this case, it's a good choice, seems to be between 4 and 8 log files, for example, depending on how short you want to have the output. A different use case that log classifier labels you is to use it against journal D. So you can directly use your system, local system logs. And one way to use it is to run this command to log reduce journal range day. What it does in the background is it creates a model from the journal logs of yesterday and then compares it to the log files of today. So the underlying assumption here is that anything that happened in the past and didn't annoy you too much is considered a good baseline. So any errors that frequently happen and you learn to live with, you want to ignore. But you want to see what is new this week or this today. And this gives you a reasonably good output. It's better if you train on a larger set of data. So similarly to what I explained before, you can use log-reduced journal to train it on like the last month of your journal entries, and then run this saved model against today's log files. And yeah, I did that against my workstation. So this is like a totally unfaked example. So you can see here the typical problems that engineers learn to ignore. So the first hit that is interesting is like this 0.7 hit, which is a very high anomaly that apparently I'm not able to receive email anymore because like my inbox is too large. So there's an error about file too large. Okay, whatever. And you can also see a different line that was printed coincidentally that apparently have an unreadable sector on one of my hard drives. And when I looked at it, I thought, okay, there must be a software problem because it's rating it as 0. So it means this is normal. And then I looked further and I realized actually, okay, I do have this error already for quite some time, so it's actually perfectly well working. I just learned to live with the error. So keep in mind, the tool only extracts what is novel compared to the baseline. And to demonstrate that, I just killed one of the processes that are running on my workstation and rerun the last step. And you can immediately see that it finds 2 more additional lines that it considers interesting, like exactly the error that I just introduced into the system. Another more advanced use case that you can think of is like using it for analyzing like SOS reports or support configs. So these are tarballs of a complete system snapshot. So it contains a lot of log files. It contains a lot of information about what was installed, what was running, what was going on the system. And it's usually very large. And it's usually taken when there's some kind of problem in the system. And it's not always obvious where the problem is coming from, or what even the problem is. You just know this tarball was taken at a point in time when there was an issue. So you can use the same machine learning principle here to compare it against the tarball that was taken when the system didn't have a problem. So that way you can remove away denoise, and you can just see what was different at that particular towel that you're interested in. And in this particular use case, the tool is actually building a machine model in the background for each log file type. So it's automatically trying to match log files that are similar and that are for the same service, and is only collecting models for each of those services. So it's not like mix and match everything together, but it's separating them out, which gives you a much better result. And also one interesting thing to show here is that it has an HTML output option. So if you prefer to use a browser, which is recommended for like really large complex log systems, then you can actually open the report and you can click and browse through it, and you can actually very quickly go to one of the files in the support config, which is called messages.txt, and it extracts you the error that was actually the root cause of that particular case, coincidentally with a fairly high anomaly rating. So in just a few seconds of waiting, you have reduced like a support config table of like several megabytes and several millions lines of, or 100,000 lines of text to find the root cause. And one last example that I want to introduce on the CLI side is that you can also use it as part of your log rotate process. So you can basically train a model on the older logs, like the logs that you have archived, so the files that have a date suffix and like a compression extension at the end. And then you can run it against the current log file. And this way you can just see what is different than what you usually have as errors or as anomalies in your system. And this is just one example. You can see this particular use case already reduces you from having to read like 6,000 lines of log files to like 500. It's probably not good enough, but it's a significant improvement over the previous workflow. And one thing that we probably have to look at is to integrate it into a centralized logging system. So when you have your logs aggregated to a central system, this is currently under progress, work in progress.
Okay, so using the tool manually may be cumbersome for some other use case, such as for continuous integration jobs. We will now see different ways to integrate anomaly detection in a CI workflow. At the end of a run, the user is presented with a list of build results, and the goal is to help him understand why some of the job failed. And CI jobs are a great target for nearest neighbor regression because the build outputs are often deterministic and previous runs can be automatically used as baselines. So we will look into the Zool CI system architecture, but the same process could apply to other CI systems. This diagram shows that the user interacts with the Zool scheduler through code review system, and the scheduler executes builds through a remote executor service. And builds are executed on test instances that are ephemeral. And at the end of the run, the executor retrieves the logs and publishes them to a log server. And finally, Zool returns the log server URL to the user. So that's the link that are showed in the code review system. And the link points at the log server artifact directory, where there are all the logs and the job output. But more importantly, Zool also stores the build information in a database. And this is a key component to make the log classify process automatic for CI logs. And this, let's see how a log classify can be used in this workflow. So the first idea use case is to run the tool on the executor node directly before the upload log task. So the main advantage of this implementation is that the job does not have to be adapted And the post-run can be simply added to the base job. But the cons are that it induces a memory and CPU overhead on the shared resources. This is an example of a base job integration. The tool comes with a Zool jobs role that are ready to be used to report the jobs condensed summary to the user. And the role is basically performing three tasks. The first one is to build a model of this particular job using the previous build execution. And then produce a report of the logs and artifacts that are present on the executor. And finally, to return the report file URL to the user so that the build result links do not present the whole jobs artifact, but start with presenting the exciting report that have been produced. Another use case is to deploy a standalone service that can be triggered after the build execution. So the trigger could be automatic, perhaps part as part of the job. After, if a job failed, then it can send a message to trigger an analysis. Or this can be requested manually by the user. The main advantage of this use case is that it enables user interaction with the classification process. For example, we can feedback false positive to remove them from the report. And it also provides a centralized index of anomalies for this job. And the disadvantage is it's an asynchronous process. That means that the build result will still point at the log artifact directories, and the user have to wait for the report to be generated. So here is the status page of Zool, and if we look at the build interface, we can grab a job that failed. And the log URL is the build result, which contains the job output, which is usually a long file of not so interesting information, but somewhere around the end there is an error that needs to be found. So instead of doing that, we can use the log classify service. And what the service needs as an input is the build UID, as well as the Zool service API endpoint. So the endpoint is used to collect the baseline so that it can learn what is a nominal build, and then it will use those baselines to extract what was the issue with that build. And then the report looks like this, where the distance is showed as a background color, and the big block at the end is the issue of that job. And as I said, it can be used to provide user feedback. So in this case, we can remove the false positive of this report. And ultimately, create an archive of that anomaly, which will contain the job output and all the distance of each log lines. So to conclude, log classify is has been created in the context of the Software Factory project. So this is an open source development forge, and the screenshot shows many of the components that can be easily deployed on-premise or as a service. And it includes components such as Gerrit, Zool, Kibana, and log classify that is enabled for processing jobs output. To contribute to the log classify project, the best is to join us on the log classify IRC channel on Freenode. And here is a tentative roadmap. one of the key items is to be able to handle the streaming logs. And to do that, we need a way to have an adaptive model to change and use perhaps other implementation that does not have the brute force limitation of the current one. And we also want to be able to produce a public domain data set of CI jobs output with the anomalous line being annotated. And that will be that will enable further research in that field and to be able to work on a common data set to test new models and find new solutions. So this concludes the presentation. Thanks for your time, and if you have any question, it's the time.
That's really cool, first of all. And is there a way to take the model back in time? Like, analyze this log with the model that you had built up 1 month ago, even though you were continuously training it for the last 3 months? Like,
You mean like refit a model with new?
Coming back to the example which Doug gave, that only this particular sector, it marked it that it has zero, and we learned to live. So had I analyzed that log with a model that was built a month ago, it would have said that this is a new error.
Yep. Yeah, I think, so I think so basically what you're asking for, I think, is like a feed-based learning. So like you're saying, okay, actually I noticed that there is an error that I tended to ignore some time ago, and now I want to actually flag this as an error and see when it started and stopped and so on. So I think this is one area of improvement for the web UI that Tristan was just showing, that it's actually when you annotated a result that you can also like say, okay, I actually want to raise the anomaly of this particular line because now that I look at it, this is one thing that I'm interested in. So currently it's not possible to do that because the baseline is already pre-built at the training phase and you cannot remove stuff. You can just add things to that. But it's definitely an idea that I was also tinkering about, but I don't have a solution for that at this point in time.
Thanks, that's really great work. Did I understand correctly that the ordering of log lines is not taken into account now? So the error could appear anywhere.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the model that is being built is designed to be inaccurate. So it's completely ignoring the order of the words in a line, as well as their relative relationship to each other. So a log line is not. It is taken as an independent line. It's not put into context at this point in time.
Do you see any kind of obvious path forward that could add that in the future?
Right now with this model, we found that's worked the best, so we use that only. But we could imagine a way that the lines are processed by two models. And then we could try to mix the result of the two models. But we still need ways to validate a new model, so that's a bit.
Could I see the QR code again?
Sure.
The QR code, I'd like to take your slides.
We'll get back to the first slide.
Yes. Thank you for sharing them.
Yep, so all the slides are online, including everything that we should have said in the speaker notes if you press S. And if there are no more questions, then I thank you very much for your attendance and enjoy the rest of the conference. Bye.